Okay, so this is the third in the four-part series I want to discuss about the different approaches to Zionism within Orthodox Judaism. Again, this is not going to cover every approach, but these are major approaches. Now, this one I wanted to talk about only because, again, this is in reference to Beverly H. She wrote this comment, and I appreciate it, and that's why I make these videos, and I thank you, and anybody else can make comments, and I might make a video about it. Not going to promise, but I might post these videos. So this is for you, Beverly, and I thank you for asking. And Beverly mentioned, you know, she seems to see that only Satmar are anti-Zionist, and for the most part, even the ultra-Orthodox seem to be supportive of Zionism, and she mentioned, you know, Muncie and Borough Park, and she also mentioned Crown Heights. You have to understand, Crown Heights is a different community than all of these others, because all the other communities are homogenous communities, particularly Muncie and Borough Park. I mean heterogeneous communities, I'm sorry. Muncie and Borough Park are extremely heterogeneous among the Orthodox world, even to the point where you also have modern Orthodox in Muncie and Borough Park. More in Muncie than you have in Borough Park. Whereas in Williamsburg, you don't really have as many. You have a very small group of modern Orthodox, and almost everyone in Williamsburg is homogeneously minus Hasidic, Strimlich, with very few exceptions. There are a few individuals and one or two shuls, for the most part, and then even the ones that are not anti-Zionist are still Strimlich, you know. All the married men, with very few exceptions, in Williamsburg were Strimlich, as opposed to in Burbank Park, where you have a very large percentage who don't wear Strimlich. Even their Hasidish, they don't wear Strimlich. But at least in Williamsburg, you have the different groups. You have the Satmar, and you have the Puppa, and you have all of the Spinker Rebbes, and then you have also Kloisenberg and Bells, and the Baba, and so forth, small group. And you'd also have a Chabad Shul. You also have, what modern Orthodox Shul is left. You have the Wiener community, which is, you know, more or less into, you know, into Satmar to a certain extent. They have their own schools and so forth, and you have the Malachim, which broke away from God, essentially joined Satmar. Then you have all the different Rebbeluch, you know, some, you know, with more influence and some with less. And that's what you have, you know, in Williamsburg. Now, then you have places that are so there is a certain level of heterogeneousness in Williamsburg. But then you have, like, Kiryas Yol, which is much more homogeneous. It's more homogeneous than Williamsburg, because in Kiryas Yol, you do not have Popa, you do not have Bells, you do not have Kloisenberg. You only have the Satmar and other groups that are aligned with Satmar, like Tosh, like Spinka and Breslev, and some other little here and there. You know, you have plenty of different shuls. You have, I don't know, about 60 shuls in Kiryas Yol. And, you know, you have the little Rebbeluch, you know, here and there who have their own shtiebel, who generally will identify, you know, with one of the Satmar factions. Usually, most of the Rebbeluch tend to go with the B'nai Yol or with Rezan Aleib. You know, and that's in Kiryas Yol. And then, you know, the next thing you have is, you know, New Square, which is totally homogenous, even more homogenous than Crown Heights, but Crown Heights is just about as homogenous as New Square. Meaning Crown Heights is almost purely, you know, New Square is purely Square Hasidim, only one shul. Lubavitch has several shuls, and Lubavitch also you have, I mean, Crown Heights has several shuls, mostly Lubavitch shuls, but some other shtiblach, which mostly were taken by Chabad, but, you know, and then you do have some modern Orthodox as well, and you also have some, you know, who grew up Chabad and still identify with their Chabad upbringing, but have their own, you know, found their own derech. That's Crown Heights. So Crown Heights, you have to understand, first of all, when you de-emphasize something for a purpose, you sometimes can lose the next generation. Meaning, this was not in Crown Heights, I was in, I think, Wayman, Connecticut for Shabbos, I don't remember where I was. And I davened Friday night in Chabad, and I was talking to the Balabas who invited me to eat by him, and he had, you know, you see the father who's an Erlich, a Hasidic, you know, with the beard and the kapata and the hat, and you see his kids almost not frum, and they're, you know, these Muslim shirts, or whatever, I don't know, you know, like, and like IDF shirts, or whatever it is, you know. And we're talking, and the father said, I didn't bring it up, I don't think, he said that Chabad is really anti-Zionist. And his son couldn't grow up learning Chabad yeshivas, did not believe him. He said, what are you talking about? Chabad is anti-Zionist. So we have to understand what's going on. What happened to Chabad? Now, Chabad, certainly everyone agrees, three generations ago, was purely anti-Zionist. The Rebbe Rishab, his anti-Zionism made the Satmar look Zionist, you know? Like, he was like Turkarta, the Rebbe Rishab. The Rebbe Ayatz was half and half. He generally, you would see him as an anti-Zionist, but he had some pro-Zionist, and he also was friendly to a certain extent with Rav Kook. That's the previous Rebbe. And then this last Rebbe, Ramash, what was his story? Where did he hold? And it would seem that he had a public persona and a private persona. Because he wanted to attract as many people as he could. He had a goal of attracting as many people as he could. And he was afraid that anti-Zionism would scare people away. And so he was really disingenuous. As for the most part today, the Haredi community is. And again, we see as the generations go on, meaning Aguda is essentially anti-Zionist, as we described in the last video. But the new generations, because they think that anti-Zionism is Satmar, so sometimes the younger people tend to be more pro-Zionist, and that's what happened to Lubavitch even more so. Because, and there were a few issues involved here. So, when we look at the last Lubavitch Rebbe, first of all, there's apocryphal stories, which we can't say are true or not, that would seem to indicate he was a very strong anti-Zionist. You can find these online, these apocryphal stories, from Lubavitch or Hasidim, not from opponents of his. It says like this. That the story goes that Lubavitch Rebbe had a subscription to Hachoma. Hachoma is a newspaper coming from Yerushalayim. Now, the Yerushalayim and Turekarta who made Hachoma are not the ones who are marching together with the Arabs. We're not talking about, like, you know, Moshe Berbek or Moshe Hirsch, these more extremists, but it was an anti-Zionist paper from the what we call the mainstream of Turekarta of Yerushalayim. One day, the Rebbe was Hachoma came out. He said, what's going on? Maybe I need to send them some money. And he said, and if they weren't doing what they're doing, I would have to do it. That's the story that goes with the with Lubavitch. Now, however, the public persona would seem to be very pro-Zionist. Maybe it's the same thing, you know, Eishet Torah. Also, you go to the website, they have the Israeli flag, and they have a lot of pro-Zionists because they want the money from the secular people. But when you really learn what's inside, and I never learned in Eishet Torah, but what I heard is that they're really not Zionists. They're really more Haredi. Maybe some people are something. Well, the same thing was in Urs HaMeach. I remember some of the Rebbeim were more Zionist, and some of the Rebbeim were more Haredi, but most of them were Haredi. When I was in Orz HaMeach, they still had Nosson Slifkin teaching there. He's very much a Zionist. Now he's Natan. You know, he was always Natan. It's just when he was in Orz HaMeach, he was Nosson. Because he was trying to have an influence and a hashpo on the Haredim. But Lubavitch, so it's like this, you know, they had their their thing, and that's it, you know, meaning they, first of all, they're totally independent, similar to the Sam are also totally independent. So let's see, how are Lubavitch Zionist, and how are Lubavitch non-Zionist, and how are Lubavitch anti-Zionist, and we can compare. We can find that all three elements exist within the Lubavitcher community. So anti-Zionism, we explained the story with Tachoma, but that's apocryphal. Public knowledge from Lubavitch. Lubavitcher Rebbe told his Hasidim not to sing Hatikvah. Not to, I'm pretty sure he said not to have Israeli flags. And also not to say it's Tefillah L'Shlama Medina. That's one part that you have that's either anti-Zionist or non-Zionist, these aspects there. The most Zionist aspect of Lubavitch is their opposition to Mesiras Shtachim, to giving away the Shtachim, the territories. The Lubavitcher Rebbe was very opposed with this. Now, the interesting thing is, what I've heard claimed, is where the Lubavitcher Rebbe learned this. There was a big tzaddik, the Boston Rav, Rav Mordechai Savitsky, Zecher Tzaddik Lavrocha. And Rav Mordechai, I had a big shaykhis with his son, Penich, the Rav in Queens, the Talachochem. So Rav Mordechai Savitsky, Rav Penich would say that his father had his foot in different places. He was a real Litvak, yet he davened Tehillas Hashem. He was anti-Zionist to the extent that often when the Hesachtus Rabbonim was looking for signatures for some kolkori they had, some poster that opposing, let's say, voting in Israel or whatever, so they could depend on getting a signature from Mordechai Savitsky from Boston. Of course, when you have the, you know, things that you assume, the anti-Zionist things you assume are, this is Satmar, so you assume you're going to get a bunch of signatures from, you know, Rabbonim in Williamsburg and Monroe, and maybe a few in Muncie, maybe a couple in Borough Park, maybe one or two in Flatbush, and then it's a big deal if you could get signatures, and then, you know, maybe Canada, you know, from Montreal and from Tosh and from Toronto or whatever. But it was a big deal if you found signatures from these out-of-town places, you know. But there were Rabbonim who were Satmar Hasidim in these other cities around the country, so you had you know, Sandra Rov in Detroit, you know, Rav Deutsch, and his brother, who's also somewhere in the Midwest, the famous, what was he, with the mikvahs, the very famous, I don't remember his name now, Big Talmud Chochem, and then you had, you know, Meislish in Chicago, and then you had, you know, all these different, you know, and you had some in L.A., Rav Lowe, and you had, you know, and you had the Briderov in Baltimore, and have the Karasteer in Miami, and all these different Rebbelach who were in different, you know, they were all Samar Chassidim. And, you know, so you had this, but this Reb Mordechai Savitsky wasn't even from Anash. He wasn't a Satmarer, he was a Litvak. And yet he would sign also on these Kol Koreis. And so he was against going to Bechiris, but he was also against giving away land because he found this in Shulchan Aruch, and he showed to Lubavitch Rebbe and Rupenich Savitsky told me that that's what Lubavitch Rebbe wouldn't have known that himself. He learned it from Mordechai Savitsky. You know, he showed it to him, and he established. Maybe some people, of course, Lubavitchers are going to be offended that I say that, but that's, you know, the historical revisionism that they're famous for. You know, it's well known. You know how yeah, there's a whole book from Yajna Rav, you know, from Borough Park. He wrote a whole book, Larger Than Life, about how, you know, what's, you know, how there's a lot of historical revisionism in the modern Chabad movement. And essentially, you know, that's, so here you had an anti-Zionist Rav who taught Lubavitcher Rebbe, the thing that he's said to be the most Zionist about is that he was against giving away land. Now, I would tend to think, in a way, that this halacha had nothing to do with Eretz Yisrael. You know, even, you know, meaning Mesira is even is an Isser both in Chutz Laretz also, including Mesira of land and of property. You know, I mean, I've often suggested that you could give up sovereignty in Israel without giving up property, meaning the Jews who live there and who own land should be able to live there and be Palestinian citizens, you know, if they want to give away, you know, for peace, they want to, meaning if they're Israeli Arabs, why can't they be Palestinian Jews? It's a good kasha. That was my whole video that was very popular from when I was talking about John Kerry. Now, the hypocrisy really of the Palestinians there. You know, how come there could be Israeli Arabs and there can't be Palestinian Jews? Why not? Except for the fact that the Palestinians aren't real peace partners. But let's go back to this. So that was the one thing they always said to Lubavitcher Rebbe. Was very pro-Zionist is that he was against giving away land. The only thing is that the Zionist government want to give away the land. You know, I remember one Kahanist, he said that they want to give away the land because they're not frum and they're anti-religious, and here they see what he, the Kahanist, understood as a fulfillment of biblical prophecy, and so they want to give away the land to prove it wrong, even though it's not exactly true, but we could say that. So what's the next thing we could say? What else can we say about Lubavitch that people would say is Zionist? Is that Lubavitch or Rebbe would meet with, you know, all the Rosh Hashanah, and or they would come to him, members of the Knesset, they would go to Lubavitch or Rebbe, and he was always very nice to them. Give them advice, and you know, so Ad Hayom, you know, Netanyahu always talks about what the Lubavitcher Rebbe told him when he was in the UN, and all these things. And that's pretty Zionist, you know, that that you have to be honest about. Now, I have one cousin who's a Lubavitcher, and he says he's very much anti-Zionist, but when he says he's anti-Zionist, it means he's against the Medina. It means that, you know, like, you know, because the Medina, they want to lock up, you know, Lubavitcher rabbis, they write to Sefer like Torah Samelech, and they want to write things that are, that go against Israeli law, and a lot of things are go against common decency that they write there in these books, that they want to say that this is halacha l'maisa, which we know it isn't. These are theoretical halachas, and maybe Mashiach comes, but this is not supposed to be practiced today. And so they take a very strong Kahanist approach, which even Kahan himself probably didn't even take, and advocate violence and so forth, and they get arrested. So then, you know, they're going to say, oh, we're anti-Zionist because we're going against what the Zionist government wants. And it's the same thing. Like, I know someone, modern Orthodox religious Zionist, who was in the army, and he didn't, and he did something against the rules in the army, and then he contacted me, he said, Rebbe, Chdaf Abrucha, well, the Zionim making a gezeira against me. Gezeira against him. He chose to go into the Israeli army, and he broke their rules. And it's not that Zionim are making a gezeira against him. He didn't follow the rules. You know, you can't go and say, oh, the Zionim. That's silly. You know, who told you to go in the army? You know, who told you to move to Israel in the first place? You were doing fine in America. You know. So. Right, so that's, you know, it's disingenuous, you know. It's, the Zionim, it's not the Zionim, it's him follow the rules. Although, you know, we got a kick out of it. My wife was like, wow, so-and-so, he talks like that, wow. But, let's be honest, all right. But really, in essence, Chabad essentially was anti-Zionist. And they become Zionists by virtue of the fact that they really, the Rebbe wanted to be intellectually dishonest because he wanted to have a shpoah on, as most of the Kiruv rabbis do. This is the same literature Kiruv, you see this in Or Sameach and Eshet Torah too. They don't want to tell the truth about Zionism because they don't want to scare people away. And so they'll say, oh, we're big Zionists even, you know, meaning it, until the point so their kids hear it, and then their kids wind up becoming Zionists. And they don't know any better because they don't know any better. And that's it. And that's what really happened in Crown Heights, to the point where the new generation, they don't have a rebbe, they don't have any hadracha, and they remembered the public ministry of Lubavitcher Rebbe, and they didn't know about his private opinions. And so they said, you know, oh, so when the Friediger Rebbe and the Rebbe Rishab, they said like this. That was in the old days, but now we have the Medina, things are different, but still we're really still anti-Zionist because we don't, you know, we're not like Rav Shach, because Rav Shach had people in the Medina, he had people in the government, and we don't have people in the government, so we're really more, they talk out of two sides of their mouth, because they want to have Hashpah on everyone, because their goal is to make everyone Lubavitch, you know, that's why I remember in Or Sameach, you know, one of the Ingalite, said he saw a Lubavitcher shliach talking, or someone doing mivtzayim, talking to a Ben Torah, yeshiva man. And then he said to him after, he says, why are you talking to him? And said, your job is to talk to the fry people, to be makar of them, they should punt tefillin. What are you talking to Ben Torah for? And he said, no, we have to be makar of everyone. We have to, because they want everyone to be Lubavitch. You know, that's what it comes down to. Be honest, you know. And if that's what they want, they think they got something great, that they should want to share it. You know, halavai, other Jews should be so happy with what they have that they want to share it with other Jews, you know. But they take it too far. Again, but I have a lot of respect for Lubavitch. They do wonderful things. and it's a very chashuv chassidus, and it's one of the oldest chassidus, and it has big chashivas to it, but it's nothing negative, it's just whatever. It's a different derech, and I'm just being honest about what really it's all about, you know. And so that's what the major part of it is. It's because they want to be Makarev everyone, so they want to, like Paul said, be all things to all people. They learned from their predecessors. I shouldn't say that. I'm sorry, but that's essentially what it is. But the new generation, because they're so ignorant, and all they know is the last Rebbe, and all they know of the last Rebbe is just the public ministry that was given out, and not what he really believed. You know, I know one time they asked Lubavitcher Rebbe, what do you have to say about the Samarov's approach to Zionism? And he avoided the question. He said, what should I say about a man who I don't even know? I think he even said, who I never even met, which isn't true. They did meet when Samarov was sitting Shiva. You know, Lubavitcher Rebbe went to Menachem Avil. Even Samarov was sitting Shiva for his daughter. Lubavitcher Rebbe went to Menachem Avil, and you know, everybody tells stories about that, which they exaggerate. So and they put their own propaganda into, but that's, you know, basically. So for sure, the younger people now in Lubavitch really are Zionists for the most part, you know, unless they. No, whatever, they parrot, but they don't really think critically about what they hear. That's the one thing. There's not that much critical thinking. It's just regurgitating what they heard. They don't, and it's strange, because you would think it's an intellectual chassidus that's supposed to be focusing on intellectual matters. Where's the intellect? Where is it? Where are they? They've lost all the critical thinking that they used to have, you know, 100 years ago, and it just became a very blind, regurgitated cult. And then the kids, they get disillusioned by it, but they still, that's all they know. So then they leave the things that they don't like, and they say, well, I'm not so Hasidic, and this and that, you know, you see the younger people, and most of those people tend to be very, very Zionist. Especially the ones that they say, oh, I'm not so Hasidic, you know, whatever. Again, I love Lubavitch, I don't have anything against them. I have a lot of respect, they do gewaltige work, and they should continue weiter to do gewaltige work. I'm not trying to fight even, also they should stop stepping on other people's toes, you know. They don't have to go and steal jobs from other people. They, you know, I mean, why they go into these communities, they already have an established shul, and when they take away, and they take away people... Instead of people don't go to shul, or they have people who, whatever, who live in the community somewhere, and they'll you know, and they'll drive, you know, 10 miles when they could walk to the local shul, the Orthodox shul, and they'll drive 10 miles to go because they have to go to Lubavitch, you know. There's whatever. It is what it is. I'm not going to change the world. Everybody has their own place, and I have respect. And Baruch Hashem, they should be in places like Idaho and Montana and Chvez, you know, where there's no one in South Dakota. You know, Baruch Hashem, there's finally a shul in South Dakota. There's finally a rabbi in South Dakota. There wasn't anything there, you know. So it's those things are gewaltig, and for that I give them all the props in the world, and they should be very matzliach and continue to do these things. And as far as Zionism, that's the story. Their roots are very anti-Zionist. Like I said, more anti-Zionist than Jakarta. And their current situation is, they're really not Zionist, but in some ways they're more Zionist than the others. Some ways they're more anti-Zionist than others. They're a little bit of everything, but really, essentially, they really are pro-Zionist, you know. Or they're pro-Zionist, but anti the Medina. They're kind of like the Kahanists. That's what it is. All right. Well, thank you for watching. God bless. Please like and share and subscribe. And I like the Kahanists. I don't have a problem with the Kahanists. And again, Lubavitchers who go to these far out places where there's nobody else, As long as they're not going into someone else's territory and not taking away someone else's job, which they sometimes do. And I know a lot of very choshev and galait who, choshev rabbonim, who just, they lost their job because of this movement. And that's a horrible thing. And sometimes they go and they attack, you know, other places, you know, and they attack other rabbonim. That's not right. That has nothing to do with Lubavitch, though, you know. But they're very territorial, whatever. All right. Whatever it is. They should be matzliach and doing good things. You know, it's not, you know, like, you know, Rush Limbaugh said he hopes that, Obama is not successful. And why? Because there's nothing that Obama wanted that he wanted to be, so he hoped he wouldn't be successful. Meaning, if he wanted good things, he would hope he'd be successful. Lubavitch, they want good things. They want Jews to run tefillin and things like that. They should be very successful. All right, God bless. Please like, share, and subscribe, and thank you for watching. All the best.